farm is about 240 acres. Consists of rotational grazed pastures and row crop corn, soybean, and grass alfalfa hay, along with a variety of diverse cover crops and sorghum sedan and such for feedstuffs. One of my main focuses was the amount of erosion because of the substantial rains we've been getting the last 3 to 5 years, and this is bluff country and it's highly erodible. With the commodities prices where they are today, if we cannot look for different ways, more efficient ways, or to harvest more capital out of our acre, I don't think we're going to survive. And so by raising a corn crop and doubling back on it with cattle and feeding them, I think that's where the true value is, all the while maintaining a living root and great diversity in the soil. It kind of started trying my hand at no-tilling soybeans into rye. And the first year we did it, that rye was about shoulder high on me, and I'm 6 foot tall, and it turned out. From there, it just progressed to wanting more covers. Last year, I was about 95% no-till on the corn. This year was 100%. Soybeans have been no-till for, I believe, 5 years now. And it just kind of progressed as I could afford to put a few add-ons on the corn planter. And it's nothing fancy, but it certainly does it. And the farther I progress, the more mellow the soil is getting. And I can already see there are components on no-till equipment that in another year or two will be obsolete for me. They won't be needed. Today, we're working on interseeding, specifically where we are right now in 60-inch rows, trying our hand at that. The theory with 60-inch rows, number one, for the purpose of the corn, it's sunlight effect. Virtually every row is the outside row, and the interseeding in it, I believe I can double my biomass production with the covers for the purpose of grazing this fall. We were interseeding 30-inch rows last year and gained about a month's worth of grazing. If we can double on that, then that's twice the feed. So cattle operation consists of about 50 mama cows, basically limousine red Angus and or cross. They are all rotational grazed. From when we go to grass, we come off of grass, and when corn stalks are ready to go on, or we graze covers along the way, and also grazing some perennial hay stands in lieu of harvesting them.
So Luke, can you tell us a little bit about the interseed rig that you have here, kind of some of the different components, when you built it, that type of thing?
Absolutely. So this was a work in progress for about 3 years. Good friend and neighbor of mine, Mike Steinfeld, and I, we had seen a conference one day out in Albert Lea, and it was something we had to have. So we went and seen Mr. Tom Cotter and looked his over, and he was more than happy to share what he knew. And so it's nothing more than a six-row rotary hoe that we traded for a load of corn stalk bales. And this is a Gandy air unit. They're actually built in Owatonna, Minnesota. This was bought used out of Mora, Minnesota, and we just adapted from there. I think your only limitations are in your mind. We've had three different drive systems, but we think we have it figured out now.
Tell us, how do you disperse seed through it?
Seed is put in the top of the box. Today it's about a 15 to 18 way cover crop mix. This is a hydraulic powered fan. He's blowing through the hoses, you can see, to the diverters. There's meters in here with wheels on them that are metering seed when I turn it on, and the air is forcing it out the hose, dropping it down behind the rotary hoe units or in the mix, spreading it out. I touch very lightly with the rotary hoe, more so in corn stalk residue to stir it up a little bit, but even today we're picking a little dirt and moving some of this rye straw we're in.
So with the rotary hoe units, because this has had cover crop last fall, this year rye, we're still finding some moisture where a lot of other fields have kind of dried out. How do you think that's going to benefit you as far as getting establishment, assuming we get some rain?
If we can pull in a half, maybe even an inch of rain to hatch the seed, and we can get a root, my moisture isn't very deep. I'm actually looking at a deer track right here, and I can see the bottom of it's wet, and that's no more than a half inch deep. And with the rye straw cover, I think we'll hold a little moisture too. Rotary hoe units, he's sitting on the ground so they're unable to spin right now. This is seed tube hose coming out, diverter or deflector. Seed is hitting that and fanning out. Everything's run off the station of the tractor through electric or hydraulic. for the most part, everything was pretty good. We had our biggest problem with hydraulics powering our fan. The blower back here is all hydraulic. It originally came to us as a wheel drive unit, so the wheel would be on the ground metering seed. We converted to a hydraulic motor to meter seed, but we actually were running out of hydraulic power. So in turn, I went to electric seed drive and made it much handier. I have a rheostat wired in on the tractor so I can control rates right from the station in the tractor. It's hydraulic controlled. The seed comes on and off with electric. It just throws the drive in or out. I run just a real cheap GPS unit to help keep track of where I've been. No auto steer, no true guidance. Rotary hole toolbar, but it's not conventional anymore. We have taken out these two sections to allow for our corn row to pass through. Our seed tubes coming from our meters hits a deflector. Very difficult to see the seed on the ground because it's so small. With the blower running, this is where our seed is metered out into the cups. Large capacity box, a little bit too large for this small farmer, but it's what we have. It's pretty effective and efficient. And as the seed flows out into the cups, it's blown out onto the ground. I run a 6-row planter. I shut every other row off. But in doing that, I double the population on the rows that are active. My normal 30-inch row acres that would be planted at about 32,000-33,000 population, we double that. And I actually just took a count in this row right here. We were 61,000 population in row, but it's still the same amount of plants per acre and fertilized as such. This ground right here was soybeans last year, and we are at no more than 100 pounds of nitrogen applied out here. Everything I do is 4 inches off the row, all my fertilizer off the planter, and as far as chemical, the only thing this field has had was one pass of Roundup to burn it down before we interseed. On the 60-inch rows, as far as the economics of it specifically, I can't tell you if there will be a yield barrier. I did a lot of my homework. I asked a lot of questions. Quite frankly, I'm not worried too much about yield loss. I know what I will gain for armor on the soil, diversity of plants, and the amount of biomass to graze this fall will outweigh even if there is a yield drag on it. And I don't have optimum cover on here. This was seeded in rye the first week in November last year. I actually was running in about 3/4 inch of frost with the no-till drill, but it worked. But as you can see, as these seeds get buried under this residue and we can pick up a little moisture, it's gonna maintain and they're gonna incubate and hatch right out of there. And if you want a bigger look, that's radishes and clovers. Your big ones are lentils and buckwheat, and I'd have to go look at my list to recite them all, to be honest with you. I should be in that 15 to 17 mark this year. I will have around 25 to $30 an acre in this. This was a huge selling point for me. The amount of biomass we had and the quality of feed, and we were froze, but the canopy of the corn kept a lot of the interseeding from freezing. Because of the feed quality, I was able to graze without supplying any supplemental protein. And for me, that's not writing a $1,000 check the day we go to corn stalks. And so maybe there's a trade-off for the seed costs.
I know you said it's around a 15-18 weight mix. What are some of the main, you know, different species you have in the mix?
Mix consists of annual ryegrass base with a large assortment of clovers, because I'm a clover fan. A lot of benefits there. Clovers establish quite easily. Nitrogen fixation. I like diversity. There's everything from flax and buckwheat in here, and then a small assortment of brassicas also.
I know the rate, you're still kind of tweaking that, but what's the approximate rate that you're trying to get here to the acre?
On the 60s and the 30s adjoining it, I'm shooting for that 26-28 pound. That's a game in itself.
Yeah, to tweak it, you mean, and get
correct.
It right.
Yep. Sure.
And how does that compare to last year? Were you about that same rate or a little bit lighter? Or?
So a year ago, we were in that 22 mark across all the acres, but I feel with the 60s and the opportunity to capture more moisture, more sunlight, if we can step it up just a little bit, that's what I feel I need to do.
And so how many years have you actually ran this? Is this the second year you've ran it on, yep, on corn?
Second year, yes.
Have you used this for other purposes, like frost seeding? I think I've heard you say you've used this for.
Yeah, that was actually our inaugural trip with it. We were blowing rye and oats down. I do not run them on the ground when I do that because it's partially frozen. We'll run out and frost seed to give us the opportunity to plant green when planting season gets here. I like armor on the soil or cover all the time. I really think that helps. Diversity has been a lot of fun. Getting your hands on things that you've never considered before as far as seed and plant type, and looking at that a lot different and using some of them plants to your benefit.
And you're doing that because you value having a live root 24/7.
365 days a year, if I can help it. There are so many benefits, Lance, that the erosion on this farm just, it went away. And not only because of the covers, but some other changes that were made. No-till and grazing some areas that maybe shouldn't have been farmed. I think that's one thing we should focus on. Do we really need to be farming some of the ground that we are? Sure. The first project I was involved with, the NRCS, a year or two after I purchased this place, we started pulling a brand new fence system with some cost share from them, and that went well. Along with the fence came a watering system, and then one of the local agents at that time, one was Colin, one was Dan Gunderson, and then I know Sue is in the local office, and I had made a comment about wanting to build a pond, and the pond led into a big waterway project, and so it just was kind of a domino effect of some things we took advantage of. It was very helpful. We had a lot of things done that maybe wouldn't have been able to be accomplished without them. The system is in place to be helpful, and it truly was. The exterior fence on this farm is 5-strand high tensile, 3-wire hot, which was all cost shared with the NRCS. There is about 11,000 foot of 1-inch water line that we installed. We have quick couplers on everything, and we either move tanks. And then in the process, went a little further, and we break up our paddocks smaller with polywire. So right now I'm focused on getting across all my grass and trying to de-head it so it doesn't get too ripe. And we're anywhere from a 24-hour to a 12-hour move right now. We're moving cows around. The pond, that was our NRCS project. That was actually from the wood line going east, about a 4-acre overgrown mess with a giant washout. And we went in and removed a lot of useless trees and pushed in a pond. And the cattle actually do not have access. It's just for the wildlife only. And I think that's the best part. We're at about 50 mama cows, primarily Limousine and Red Angus cross, about 90% bull bred. We do some AIing on our heifers. I've always calved early, and every year I'm calving a little later, just a little less stress and a little less battle with Mother Nature. The bulk of what I have is perennial pastures, but in the last few years we're putting in covers. I just came off a week-long graze of some rye and hairy vetch and some residual brassicas from last year, and within the next couple days here we'll be planting some more covers to get them out on yet this fall. And for the first time ever, I frost seeded a pasture in of all annual crop, and we'll be in there within the next 10 to 14 days, I would imagine. When we are breaking down our larger paddocks, the smaller, it's one poly wire, all step-in posts, and it's all on a reel, and it's as fast as you can walk or ride your Ranger, however you want to do it, and we'll pull up several hundred feet or a quarter mile or a half a mile of fence in a matter of minutes, and we let them into the next one. The longer the cattle are not in a dry lot is more economical. Number one, it's less manure to haul, less mud, it's less stress, it's less chores for me, it's less feed. When the cattle are on the land and your pastures are managed properly, I wholeheartedly think it's the best thing for the land. It all comes down to management, I believe. I've been here quite a few years, so I know my land, I know my strong and weak points. So when we came to grass this year, we basically moved through at such a rapid rate to try to de-head all of our grass species to maintain some quality. I have a larger focus on high density stock rates now. We are just, for example, 50 pair on 2 acre for 24 hours. And what we're doing is we're laying down a trampling effect. So we're putting some grass back on the ground to help feed the underground biology and protect it. That'll pay its dividend later on. And then we move the cows on before it's overgrazed. Every farmer knows once fall comes, we're tired out. And when the cows can go graze on their own, that's more family time. That's time for me in the deer stand. Time to do all the other things I haven't caught up on yet. So if the cows can feed themselves, then that's a little time earned. I live and farm here with my wife, Holly. It'll be 13 years this fall, along with my three daughters also. Willa's 11, Malia's 8, and Emery is 5. I can honestly say going down this path, I think it's brought me even closer, especially with the girls. They're a little more involved with rotational grazing, and we have some horses, and my daughters love to ride. The cows, for the most part, move easily, paddock to paddock, and it's an effort to get the girls a little more involved, and so we bring the horses out, and they push cows along and bring in the stragglers. It's good fun for everybody, and the horses get out and about. It keeps them involved in different things like that. It takes a family component and makes a dad proud. With the journey, there comes a thirst to learn more and want more. When you start doing things like 60-inch rows or interseeding or planting green into 5 and 6 foot tall rye, you can start to feel like a bit of an outlier, like there's nobody around and all the, let's call them conventional farmers around you look at you different, and that can be tough. But when you get in and realize there's a network and make a lot of good friends and the willingness to share. I talk to people all over the country and everybody is so good with trying to help you out. Everything from no-tills to covers to grazing, and I've made a lot of good connections along the way. There's a laundry list of field days and the information on the internet, I mean YouTube. You just Google some of it or pick up a book. I'm not saying I'm doing it all right or any of it right, but we're trying it. I think if you get to the pasture, I think one of the things I cringe when I drive around is I see overgrazing. And then you get erosion and you get grass that's a little far set back that all of a sudden you're going to have to reduce your stocking rate or supplemental feed. If you're a row crop farmer, rye is easy. We've planted it when we shouldn't plant it, and we plant it when we should plant it, and it almost always works. You don't need a lot of specialized equipment. Give it a try. Put it out on the back 40 so your neighbors don't see it if that bothers you. I take a little pride in planting stuff right along the main road now because I like doing that. If you want to try something different on the cattle end, maybe take that piece of production ground that isn't so productive because we all have it. Maybe we bring the livestock out there. Put in something simple, a 3, 4, 5-way cover mix. Put the cows across and see what they can help you capitalize on. I truly believe that I cannot make any more money per acre unless I can adjust my inputs and my costing that way. And so what the land prices are, the chances of me ever owning more land to produce more is probably pretty nil. So why not try to do a better job with what I have?